Meine Damen und Herren,
there we go, Rog.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
Well, no, I'm not falling over, Roger. No.
By 1980, Reed was beginning to hone his unique approach to TV appearances.
Ollie Reed is the superstar who stayed. He earns millions per picture, pays a great deal of it back in tax, and still he stays. The reason is largely this: Broom Hall.
By the time Valerie Singleton paid Reed a visit, Broom Hall had become a millstone around his neck. To pay for its upkeep, he was taking virtually any part going, most of them instantly forgettable.
He chose to stay with what he was comfortable with, and his work probably suffered as a result of it.
What is the history of the house, Ollie?
Well, it's been a house here since 1010, and then it was added on to 1744, and then it's Victorian, and the whole thing is,
The consummate on-screen professional had begun to fool around.
Then I do.
It's not very easy to tie people down here because there's so many people that recognise people and they have to say hello. And Oliver Reed, of course, is very much in demand because he's starring in The Three Musketeers, playing the role of Athos. That is the correct pronunciation, isn't it?
Right. Good. I used to change it depending on the night before.
Really? Why? What would you change it to?
Athos.
Oh, Athos. You settled for Athos or Athos?
I don't mind.
What about these decorations? They're rather splendid decorations, if the camera can pick them up. Could you tell us about those?
Yes, they were given. This one is a musketeer's. We made a pact in France. They were given to us in France when we opened it, and there are such things as musketeers. And they made us musketeers, and we promised that we'd all wear them tonight, and I'm the only one that dared do it. And this one is very generous decoration from Arts and Sciences in France, and so I'm a member of that. I still can't add up.
Looks very splendid. I noticed in one of the press handouts on you, Oliver, that you are rather keen on getting away from the permissive type of film. Not yourself, but you're not terribly pro-permissive film. Is that right, or is this a mistake on my part?
No, I think that I've just finished a film called The Ten Little Indians, which was a follow-up to this one. I think that probably I helped perpetrate the image of the cinema as it's been going, and I think I'd like to change it. It's just like commering one's life a little bit.
You'd like, in other words, get back to more to the entertainment side of filming, like this film, for example.
I hope so.
Yes.
I hope so.
What I know that another ambition is to retire. I hope that's not going to be true.
I thought of that, but now I breed horses, and they cost so much to feed.
So you've got to keep working to breed the horses.
I hope so.
What is your next film? Can you tell us?
Well, yeah, I'm making a rock musical called Tommy. It's an opera, actually.
Well, is that the one by The Who, Pete Townsend?
That's
is that right.
That's right.
Oh, great. And will you be appearing in that as well?
I'll be appearing in it and singing in it, yes.
And singing in it?
Directed by Mr. Ken Russell, my favourite director.
Yes, of course. I mean, how many films have you made with Ken Russell?
Five.
Five films. Does that include the television film?
Including the television. Yeah.
Well, Oliver Reed, thank you very much indeed for joining us, and keep going with the entertainment.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Oliver Reed.
If one is going to play a heavy in a film, and the great difference between the really dangerous man and the loud man is the dangerous man has a great silence about him. And so always I find I have terrible trouble with sound men, because I'm known in the business as the whispering giant. But my eyes are quite hard, you see. Don't blink. The screen is so wide, you see, that it makes every eye about 6 foot across. And if the audience is supposed to be frightened of you, and you start blinking like this, like Bambi, a lot, which some people are sometimes inclined to do when they're nervous, then it sweeps across the screen and it's not as convincing as if you're going to be deadly. You never see a cobra blink, do you?
No, you don't.
Another thing you do, don't pay it with curly hair either. Get your hair, you know, straightened out.
Why can't a villain have curly hair?
No, villains have straight hair. Idiots have curly hair. You want to come in there with curly hair, doing this with the eyes? What, doing the whole gambit so auntie can see you? Don't smile, you're a villain. And then the accent. How are you going to play it? Let me hear you live.
Here's a copy for you. That's my first speech. As you can see, it says, Ice Cream Man
Deadly. Cometh, right.
I'll just do the first line, if I may.
Yeah.
I told you, old man, to leave us alone.
I beg your pardon?
I told you, old man, to leave us alone.
Are you serious?
Well, I was trying
to... I can't understand what you're saying.
I was trying quite hard.
And you're shouting it because you've been to RADA and the sound man has told you speak up. I've just told you to speak softly. I told you, old man, leave us alone.
I told you, old man, to leave us alone.
Why are you doing that with your mouth? You trying to kiss me?
Keep the mouth.
Well, you don't have to say, leave us alone. You're doing enough with the accent, aren't you? You don't have to give it all that with the trumpet. You're not playing a trumpet. Right, try it again.
I told you, old man, to leave us alone.
Much better. Much, much better.
I've got another line which I think is really going to give me trouble here. It's, what are you fools doing in here?
No, you've got some more.
Get him.
You've got some more here. I told you, old man, leave us alone. You're going to get the young lady into trouble. What are you going to do to her? Or what's the young man doing to the young lady?
I don't know.
No, well, why are you saying the lines that you don't understand? Don't use your hand like that. Villains don't do that. Bank managers and professors do that. Start to live your part from now on. Right. Take it from the top. Deadly.
I told you, old man, to leave us alone. You're going to get the young lady in trouble, but not half as much trouble as you're going to get yourself.
Good. Now why don't you pause it? I told you, old man, leave the young lady alone. Pause. If you don't, you're going to find yourself in even more trouble than my grandmother when she was sucking eggs.
Trying hard not to laugh.
You're not listening, are you?
Piss.
Oh, God, I don't know. Bloody joke. Go on, piss off. Bloody think you're a hard man. Go on, piss off. I don't know. Come on, I'm trying to tell you.
Piss off!
Dear, bloody dear.
You were teaching at Sandhurst. Mm. I mean, you're trained not to let that impinge on you.
In 1991, Reed appeared on Channel 4's open-ended intellectual forum to give his perspective on male violence. He was drinking from the outset.
Your emotions, and it's the ultimate thing is...
The discussion turned to women's motivation for abortions. Reed became increasingly aggressive and incoherent.
No bullshit, it's all down to whether or not she wants to get shafted.
Yes.
That's it. Everyone's very happy and better.
I'm not against divorce. So,
well, we've already
but I am against
that.
But that's it. Well, we got beyond that.
Okay.
No, we haven't got beyond that. That's
she's
what it happens
right
at the end. 10 years later, first year, does he
that
really shaft me? Does it come down 10 years? Years later, does he still shaft me? Sorry if I seem I'm drinking wine, but that's what happens. Not saying it's my wife.
I really would like to get on.
But that Castaway, the movie, it's based on a true story. What attracted you, apart from the obvious talents I saw there on the beach, what attracted you to the role?
Well, it's a funny thing you should answer these questions that I'm going to ask you.
I get the feeling this could be fun as well.
I want to understand, Les, that it's extraordinarily difficult for me to be able to follow comedians. And they asked me when I knew that I was going to be on your show. I was immensely excited. And
you really look it.
And I thought, how do you follow Monsieur Starr? And so I went to my tailor and found out that Sandy Gore and I both had splits in our trousers.
Why did you choose that film? But I'd rather ask you something else.
He did the job. Everybody was taking me for a villain, and suddenly I could play a teddy bear.
You're a cuddly character in this.
Yes. Well, I lost weight for it.
Four stone?
Yes, I did.
I was... Why did you do that? Was that vanity or was that the fact you're going to run around stark?
No, because... If anybody goes to see this movie, there's such a storm. And I mean, I had it in Women in Love, which is the last time I had to my trousers off. You understand? But there was a storm.
But you're not shy about taking your strides off, are you? I mean, you... And I'm told that you do have...
Am I helping you?
No, but it doesn't matter. I'm here to find out little things about you that we do not know. And there's one thing that I was told I can't believe. You have a tattoo in a very unusual place.
Yes, on my...
I was told that you might answer in a different way, answer that, but...
Sorry, on my winkle.
On your winkle. Why would you do a thing like that? Wasn't it painful, Oliver?
Well, strange enough, I was in Barbados, and I'm a great fan of cricket.
Cricket?
Yes, incidentally, Parky, I met today, he's promoting this... he's giving prizes for the Roo brothers. He said, regards. But I was in Barbados, and I watched cricket in Barbados, and we had a bet, and then they put a red cricket ball. Actually, it was a black ball cricket club on my shoulder. And I waited until I was 43, because when I was in the army, everybody used to have tattoos, and we always thought we were very grown up. And then I had an eagle's head put over the top of it, because I thought the cricket club wasn't butch enough. And so people said to me, why have you got an eagle's head and a cricket ball on your shoulder? And I used to say, you should see where it's perched. One day, I was on Christmas Eve, and I was... There's a pub called the Cock and Bull on Sunset Strip in Los Angeles. And I was with a dear friend of mine called John Miller, who claims to have found Lord Lucan and got lots through his flak jacket. And so we had a bet and went off to this little Korean tattooist who refused to tattoo me on that part of my anatomy. But his wife said she would. So I went upstairs and I thought, I've got to see it through. And this is being very serious. There's no joke attached to this. Very serious. Made my eyes water. And so Miller phoned up my girlfriend at the time, the beautiful Josephine. And said, the Josephine always upstairs subbing as Wooly. Done with
You ever wish you'd never said anything in the first place?
No, it's a long story. We've got 7.5 minutes.
Yes.
Anything else?
And you sold your little part of Surrey and went there. What do the locals make of you? I mean, what do you do? What is it, someone like you who's a bit of a hellraiser? What are you doing going?
Well, the only reason I chose... somebody knows Guernsey. The only reason I chose Guernsey is because of the winter. And in the winter, when it gets very rough and the sailors can't go out and fish and catch their nets, and the fish is full of nets in their lobster pots and things, they celebrate the winter by imbibing. And it's a way to get to know the local crop. Plus the fact that they grow flowers, and when flowers don't see, plus the fact it's one of the few places that I know in the world that I can trust my daughter to walk down the street.
Very beautiful. That movie there, I've only caught a glimpse of, and I'm told it's going to be very successful, but are you happy with the kind of role?
No, actress. I've got to pay my electricity bills, and a lot of people have always been, haven't we all? And we have. And I want to retire. I want to write children's books, and I think...
Children's books?
What is that expression, out of the
mouths of... Well, I don't know what tattoos you're going to put in that, but I did say in the introduction, Oliver...
Star will tell you.
Yeah, actually, you and him are a right-wing double, you two. I was told that Oliver, you know, is a character, be fun, and he's never dull, and I'd certainly agree with that. He's certainly not dull, is he? Ladies and gentlemen, Oliver Reed, we wish him every success.
Wow, I could make this little jumping cuckoo monk a lot of money, but didn't know him 17 years ago because nobody had seen him, let alone me. I was interested in crumpet in those days, not neurotic jumping balls.
And we went into the study and had a few whiskies and said to him, do you know, I could make you a lot of money. And Hurricane, being Hurricane, said, how? Because he's such a mean bastard. He really is a mean bastard. Except that he gave me an overcoat for my birthday last year in Dublin, this year in Dublin, and a box of chocolates. And I'm sure that he got the overcoat off a very great friend of his who supplies all his clothes in Dublin, but who was very sweet. So Alex probably got it off him, and he probably got one of his birds to pay for the box of chocolates, which incidentally made me sick. And anyway, after Hurricane had left the table, I said we could make a lot of money, and he said, but people will recognize me. And I thought, there is the rub.
The door bursts open, and Oliver Reed walks in, and I never realized he was such a big guy. Big, big guy. He looked like a big bear walking in. He orders a drink, and I'm standing by the bar, and he's looking. That's a big dish spread, and he just looks around, and he looks at me, and he goes, oh, I see tattoos. And I says, oh, fuck me, he's legless, and he's going to start on me. And he goes, I have a tattoo. And I go, oh, really? And he goes, would you like to see my tattoo? And I said, well, I think expecting to show me a fucking anchor or something on his arm. I go, sure. He gets his dick out, and he's got a... I can't remember what it was. I didn't really take that much of a look, but he had a tattoo on the end of his dick, and he gets it out in the bar.
A friend of mine came back off patrol. He's in the Navy, and he was up in Norfolk, in Norway, rather. And a few months ago, he telephoned and asked the publican, who is his father, whether or not he could give me a rum. And last Sunday, I was asked out to lunch by the couple that owned the pub, and I met this sailor again, and I returned the rums. But I'm not used to it. And so I got fairly merry. And a friend of mine was staying in the Jamaica, in the, where was it? The Duke of Normandy Hotel. And I was trying to see if he was in there. So I went to open the window like that, and my hand went through it. And it turned out to be the staff quarters and not the room that I was looking for anyway. And I thought I had my swimming costume on because I was due to go swimming. But apparently the law tell me it was my underpants. And I thought I was Billy Two Rivers.
So you were slightly over the...
Oh, yeah, I was. It was fair and square, and I was shoved in the slammer for a couple of nights, which was an experience I don't want to go through again.
How did they look after you there, then?
Very, very well. I think that I should recommend a new cook to them, but then I don't suppose they were there for our benefit of our stomachs, are we? But no, they treated me very well.
It's unlike you to get the wrong side of the law, actually.
Yes, I always prefer them to be on my side. They gave me enough warnings, apparently. They told me to go, and if I stayed in the boarding house, then that would be okay.
But you kept coming out?
I kept on coming out to have a chat with them, you see, and which wasn't the right thing to do. And
you squared up to one of them, apparently.
Yeah, but I was giving it that. You know, I couldn't have been serious.